comes up. Welcome everybody to another episode of Sidewalk Empire. I'm here today. I am very blessed to have today with me a very special guest. So this is Nathan Martyn. This is Mr. Nathan Martyn. Now, Nathan is a whiskey and cigar connoisseur. I can like to call you a connoisseur, Carl.
I think so. I think we're all developing connoisseurs to some extent.
Absolutely, man. So, now, I met Nathan at a cigar evening in Brisbane. Actually, we worked it out. It was exactly about a year ago. It was the first Origin game.
Yep.
There at West End at Phil's Cigar Night, remember? Yeah, so now Nathan really knows his stuff about cigars and whiskey, so this episode is actually going to be a cigar tutorial. Now we're not going to discuss whiskey too much, it's actually more about the cigars. So now we're all set up, we've got American Honey Bourbon today, so that should be good. Have you tried that one before?
I haven't yet.
Oh well, you're about to find out, mate. So we've got the humidor, we've got the cigars, we've got the cigar cutters, we've got the mood, you know, we're going for a very prohibition style this evening. So let's have a chat, man.
Absolutely.
Mate, fire away.
Okay, look, some people with their cigars, they prefer something, they'll have a preference. They'll like either Robustos or their, there you go, Cuban. Or their smaller cigars, they'll like something full body, medium body, light. I like a variety. I like different cigars for different occasions. So what I've chosen for tonight is a Romeo and Juliet Petite Corona Midi Fleur. Because it's it doesn't take as long to smoke as some cigars, and the Mille Fleur, that essentially means 1,000 flowers. This thing is meant to have a lot of different scents that you can pick up, and to be honest, every single time I smoke one of these, I pick up something that I missed last time. So it's always an interesting cigar, and it's always a journey. In terms of cutting, I think the main way you'll know is people who use the guillotine, where they'll just snip the tip. Personally, I prefer to hole punch. So this cigar lighter of mine, it actually comes with a little hole punch that pops out. It's bladed, and I pop that into the end of the cigar.
That's awesome.
Give it a bit of a twist. And then, most of the time.
That's a pretty cool contraption you got, by the way, man.
Thanks. It's actually a gift from my brother-in-law.
Yeah, right.
And tonight, it's actually...
Yeah, it's always the way. The cigar knows it's been filmed.
It does. It's nervous. Okay. There we go.
Beautiful.
So, the reason why I like the hole punch, it makes a much smaller hole. And as a result, when you're smoking the cigar, if you cut it normally, just with the guillotine, you'll sometimes get those little bits of leaf on your mouth. It's not a huge issue. Some people don't like it. With the hole punch, I've got a nice easy draw. I'm not getting any bits of cut up leaf in my mouth. What did you bring to that smoke?
Well, that was awesome, man. I actually learned something then, so thank you, sir. Alright, so into the humidor we go. Now, I've got a number of cigars. There's a bit of a backstory actually to my cigar, so I'll get stuck straight into it. So I've got a Monte Cristo number 2. Now this is a big boy. Now this is a torpedo. Now, I actually like these. They're very full-bodied, but it's not too intense. Sometimes, like as you know, like the larger you go, sometimes the more intense that the smoke can be. I don't like, I love the smoothness of this. When I have a cigar, I'm not into strong flavors. I don't like the thick taste of tobacco. I'm more into a nice light draw, something I can maybe suck back on maybe once every minute. So maybe once every 60 seconds I'll have a drag. So this is perfect, and this will probably burn for, I reckon about, depending, but I reckon about 50 minutes I can normally get out of a bad boy like this. Now, there's a bit of a backstory behind this. So I was in Cuba about 6 weeks ago. I was in Havana, and I think it was like day 2 in my Havana, and I hadn't actually picked up any cigars yet. Been so busy sightseeing and doing all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, you're distracted.
Oh, mate, unbelievable. And the irony is, I actually struggled finding a cigar shop in Havana. I actually struggled because a lot of them are out. A lot of them get sold off to tobacco shops. So in Cuba itself, it's actually hard to find a lot of cigar brands, which is fairly ironic. But anyway. So when Courtney and I got a taxi ride around Havana in a 1957 Chev, you know, we're driving around like the Malecon on the Caribbean, driving through old Havana, so all the old buildings. We drove past the Capitol building, It's amazing. But anyway, I asked the driver, where is a good tobacconist I can get a cigar? Because the problem with Cuba is that because it's so tourist-based now as well, they sell a lot of fake cigars.
Yeah.
So they can hit you with fake cigars. So I was very aware of that. So I said to my driver, where can I get good, authentic cigars from? He said, go to the cigar factory. But he said, it's Sunday today, so it's closed. I'm like, man. He said, it's all right. Just, you can go tomorrow. So we're driving along. 10 minutes later, he stops outside this building. He said to a Courtney and I, just come with me. I'm all right, cool. I'm thinking, I hope I'm not gonna get murdered or something, because I was kind of freaking out a little. So we jump out of the car and there's just two security guards. So anyway, walk up security guards, we're thinking, this is sus. Like, I'm thinking, dude, can we just get back in the car? Like, you know, this is... But anyway, the guard said, all right, come on, come through. So they took us into this big room and then into this little room to their office, and they had all these cigars in there. They had like Cohibas, Monte Cristos, Partagases, Bolivars, and they said, and they were cheap as hell. Like, this retail probably for about $60. I picked this up for about $10 in Cuba. And I thought, this is sus, like, and they said, no, it's all real. Like, it's all real. So I picked it up, and we jumped back in the car, and then we went. So it was technically closed, the cigar factory, but yeah. I think it was a bit of a side business that like the guards had going on.
Yeah.
So that's the backstory behind this actual cigar, guys. So, but what I do with my cigars, just unlike Nathan, I like to clip mine, like so. So what I'll normally do is, because this is a torpedo, I only clip off the very, very end, just the very, very end. Because like Nathan said before, if you cut too much off, you get too much leaf just in the mouth. So, but this is my go-to cigar for weddings, for bucks parties, for wedding anniversaries, stuff like that. I wouldn't normally have a cigar this size. This is probably 3 times a year for me. Like I said, I'm not really, I don't like real powerful kind of cigars, but this one, for the size, it's actually quite a nice light smoke.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's interesting to compare the two of these as well, because if you look at this one, this one is perfectly rounded, whereas if you look at mine, it's got a little bit of a rectangular sort of look to it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like you put it on the table, it'll wobble, but it doesn't roll too much. And that's because this is hand rolled. This is what's called box pressed. And that's basically just where they put a little bit of pressure on it and squeeze it in beside the other cigars within the box. And what that does, other than giving it the square shape, is it makes a more even draw and helps to enhance that flavor coming through.
Yeah, it's amazing, man. See, you know so much about cigars. Like, I mean, I know a little bit, but your knowledge is incredible, man. You're like a wealth of knowledge.
To be honest, I started out just like you, would occasionally smoke a cigar, maybe special occasions, things like that. I got a little bit more into it. And because there's not much of a cigar culture here in Australia, other than talking to other people, it's sort of self-taught. I'll order a cigar online and get it brought in at home, and then the first time I sit down and smoke it, I'll sit down, I'll think about what I'm smelling before I light it, and think about what sort of flavors I'm getting on the smoke, and I'll sort of try and write those down. And then after I've done that, I'll look around other reviews on the cigar from people who know a little bit more than me, and find out how my tastes compare. You know, I notice tastes of cedar, and then somebody else says, oh yes, cedar, and you know, hints of chocolate, and then you'll puff away again, and you'll think, yeah, actually there is chocolate. And so, if you go to my blog, whenever I get a new cigar, I always do a blog article about it. And that's what I've done. I've tasted the cigar, I've thought about what I'm finding, I've done my article, and then I've sort of done a little bit of fact-checking. And sometimes, from other people's tastes, you'll pick up something that you may have missed the first time around. And that's why it's always a journey. Every single time you smoke a cigar, if you've had it before, you're going to notice something a little bit different, which is nice.
Absolutely, man. So, what would be your cigar of choice at the moment? Like, what would be your go-to cigar for something for a real special occasion?
This is a new one that I haven't had before. My brother-in-law and a good friend of mine both recently had kids, and as the person who's into cigars in their life, I was the one who bought them a box of cigars to celebrate that. So I got a box of this brand called My Father Cigars, and I tried one the other day for the first time, and these ones are really nice, but they've got this really interesting characteristic that consistently happens. When you light it and smoke it, you get hit with this massive punch of tobacco.
That's
it
nice.
Comes across. That first two or three draws comes out like a full-bodied cigar. And then you leave it for about 30 seconds, and then the rest of the cigar is just smooth sailing. It's really medium-bodied, it's easy to smoke.
I love the wrapper.
Yeah. But just that first hit that happens is so different to the rest of the cigar. And it's just this interesting little quirk. And I don't know how they did it. I don't know how you could specifically make sure that one part of the cigar is a little bit stronger than the rest. But at the moment, this is the one that I'm finding interesting just because it has that little hint of extra character.
Yeah, see, I normally find the first quarter of a cigar is always a bit rough. Like, it's always a little bit, you know, it just tastes like a big cigarette sometimes, and, you know, I hate cigarettes. So, but then once you get to the middle of it, it really starts to, you can really taste the spices coming through, the aromas coming through.
Yeah.
And I find the Monte Cristos, the Cohibas are really well known for that. But you know what? I'm fine. I had a Partagas the other day, a Torpedo, and that was actually amazing.
Yeah.
That burned so consistently. I thought that was one of the nicest cigars I've ever actually had.
Yeah. I'm a big fan of Partagas. Probably the nicest cigar I've ever had. I can't remember what type it was because I was still early in the cigars, but it was a Davidoff. And that thing, on the first draw, every single breath of smoke was just like white silk. And it was consistent the whole way through. Like, even I was trying to hold on to the end of it with a pair of pliers just because I wanted to get those last few draws. I
had get every single little bit out of
burning my fingers, but even that last bit, because often a cigar can get dirty as more and more smoke is going through it, even those last few draws, it was just pure white heaven.
Far out, man. Like, see, you know your stuff about cigars, and this is why I got Nathan in, because I love cigars, but this guy knows his stuff about cigars. Yeah, unreal, man. Well, mate, enjoy your drink. Have some of your drink, man. So, but guys, look, we're just going to wrap that up. We're not going to say too much more about that. That's fine. So, now, Nathan, you do have a blog, don't you?
Yes, I do. If you go to nathmartyn.com, there's a blog tab in there, and that's where I tend to review my cigars. Sometimes whiskey, that usually a whiskey review for me will be done through maltwhiskeybrisbane.com, which is a monthly whiskey tasting club that I'm chieftain of. So that's once a month in Brisbane. If you enjoy whiskey, it gives you a chance to try something that you might not normally pick out in a bottle shop.
That's so cool, man. Like, you're part of so many things. I absolutely love it. Alrighty guys, that's a wrap. Well, we're going to enjoy these cigars now. So I'm going to have my Monte Cristo, and you're going to have your... Yeah, there you go.
Romeo and Juliet.
Alrighty guys, well, thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you all soon. And on this episode, at the bottom, please follow the link through to our website, and we'll see you all soon. Solo Empire! Cheers, man.
Thank you.
That's great. That's boss.
That is sweet. Have you ever had Drambuie?
No.
Drambuie is it's a whiskey liqueur that's done with honey.
Yeah.
Very similar to that.
Yeah. Yeah, it's actually, that tastes nice to the cigar. Guy, that's it.